Hello, welcome everyone to our next PTC user expert speaker series. My name is Ron Watson, and I am the director of content for PTC user. I'd like to welcome you to the next installment, 2020 Vision, Past, Present, and Future of CAD and PLM with PTC Products. And David Martin is joining us again.
Thank you all for attending. Welcome to my talk on 2020 Vision, looking at the past, present, and future of CAD and PLM with PTC Products. And I promise this is the only time I'll make any kind of connection between the year and 2020 hindsight. And also, this is a recap of the presentation I delivered back in January at the PTC User Winter Technical Community event. And so, the past event in Scottsdale in January was actually my first West Coast one of these, and some of you may have attended the ones in Needham in January, and you might have remembered making a mad dash to Logan Airport as snow was heading in. Speaking of the past, I wonder how long some of you have been involved with PTC's CAD and PLM products. During the January event, I took a poll of when people had started using the different CAD products. So for example, when I asked people about Creo Parametric 1.0, which came out 9 years ago, about half the people raised their hands. And as I started progressing through the past to Wildfire 1.0, and then to Pro Engineer Release 12, and then Pro Engineer Release 1, the number of hands kept on decreasing. But we actually did have one person who was actually on Release 1.0, which came out back in 1988, and that was a gentleman from NASA. Looking at the PLM history, we can see that Windchill 10.0 came out back in 2011. If you're on Windchill 7.0, that was from 2004. Pro Interlink 3.x was actually kind of popular among the attendees, and that one is over 20 years old. And we even had a few people who were on Pro PDM and Pro Project. So we had quite a few centuries of CAD and PLM experience attending the conference. And as I said, this talk is a look at the past, present, and future of CAD and PLM. So I'm going to jump around in time. Let's go back to a time before the Battle of Upstate New York, before the blip, before the Battle of Sokovia. Join me in the year 2008.
I'd like to open a new project file, index as Mark II.
Shall I store this on the Stock Industries Central Database?
Actually, don't know who to trust right now. Till further notice, why don't we just keep everything on my private server?
Working on a secret project, are we, sir?
I don't want this winding up in the wrong hands. Maybe mine can actually do some good.
So just a little fun with Tony Stark. Isn't it cool that the hero of the Marvel Cinematic Universe is a mechanical engineer? Did you notice some of the CAD data management operations we saw here? Revise, save as, effectivity, supersession, obsolescence, and access control. Today, 2020, design can't be performed automatically by software, but let's take a closer look. How far away is this from augmented reality? And what is Jarvis besides an artificial intelligence voice assistant? We have those today. The Amazon Echo, by the way, was designed in Creo Parametric. Let's watch one last clip from this movie.
From him tonight.
The render is complete.
A little ostentatious, don't you think?
What was I thinking? You're usually so discreet.
Tell you what, throw a little hot rod red in there.
Yes, that should help you keep a low profile. The render is complete.
Yeah, I like it fabricated. Paint it.
Commencing automated assembly. Estimated completion time is 5 hours.
Don't wait up for me, honey.
So there's some pretty nifty CAD modeling there. What did we see? There was some generative design, 3D printing, with some rendering thrown in. In 12 short years, we've gone from comic book fantasy to elements of reality. You know what that says to me? We should be dreaming big. Not just now when we're talking about Creo Parametric and Windchill, but also for our company's products and for our day-to-day lives. And so that brings me to my key point. 2020 is an absolutely amazing time to be involved in computer-aided design and product lifecycle management. We have to think big and think bigger about what CAD and PLM can do and can be. This is a critical time for deciding the future direction of how we perform product development. To do this, we have to take the best of what worked in the past, but only as it makes sense with new technology. We have to apply new thinking and first principles to the old ways of doing things. But first, let's take a look at the past and present so we can talk about the future. Let's take a quick recap of the past year and some of the advancements. This past March, Creo Parametric 6.0 was released. Creo Simulation Live had a number of advancements, including the ability to work on assemblies. In additive manufacturing, there are a host of new lattice structures, like voxel-based, stochastic, and user-defined. There's support for slicing in 3MF file formats, and you can analyze and optimize the build direction. In Creo Parametric 6.0, users can publish up to 10 augmented reality experiences, and there are a bunch of user interface enhancements that I really like. The ribbon tab for commands contains help information about the feature you're creating or editing. Most of the icons include text that explain what they are, and you have many toolbars inside of features. Windchill 11.2 was released in June 2019. Here are just a handful of enhancements. You can edit attributes during save as operations. You can also perform save as for process plans. Dynamic visualization, representations based on CAD occurrences, supports image and contributing image links. Windchill system attributes can be shared to CAD. A bill of materials on a Creo Parametric drawing can report Windchill attributes from the CAD model's corresponding WT part. You can now conduct full track online change review boards. You have plant specific bills of material for MPM link. Windchill now has direct integration with Creo Illustrate, no need for the Windchill Workgroup Manager. And PartsLink can classify documents in addition to models. In ThingWorks 8.5, the 3D viewer widget, known as the ThingView 3D viewing component, was released. It supports a whole bunch of neat stuff, like exploding assemblies. View states are also supported. The big thing, though, is the release of the new Navigate Contribute app. You can now review and approve change requests using ThingWorks Navigate. In 2019, PTC released MathCAD Prime 6.0 with a bunch of great features, including custom margins, headers, and footers, spell checking, hyperlinks, find and replace now works on subscripts. You can print only the selected content or a range of pages, a bunch of new chart component functionality, like zoom in and zoom out. You can save images of the charts in a variety of different file formats, and there are more predefined chart templates. Finally, there's a new symbolic engine for solving. MathCAD now has its own website split off from the PTC website, mathcad.com. Check it out. And in November of 2019, PTC completed the acquisition of Onshape. For those of you who aren't familiar with it, Onshape is a cloud-based CAD program that works through your web browser. That means you can use it on Windows or Mac or a tablet or even a smartphone, and the basic accounts are free. Onshape was started in 2012 by the founders of SolidWorks. That means some of the founders of SolidWorks now work for PTC. Could you have imagined that a year ago? In November, I got to meet David Corcoran. He's one of the founders of both SolidWorks and Onshape. He's had quite an impact on the world of computer-aided design, and he's still going. I want to share something that he shares in his presentations. David talks about the four great milestones in CAD history: the advent of computer-aided drafting in the 1970s, 1980s, the development of parametric modeling with the introduction of ProEngineer in 1988, the migration of CAD to personal computers in the early 1990s, and the introduction of cloud-based CAD in 2015. The first three developments occurred by 1995, so there are a couple decades between major milestones. I've got to tell you, the more I use Onshape, the more I believe it's the real deal. I'll talk more about Onshape later. So those were some of the big PTC happenings in 2019. In April, next month, PTC will release Creo Parametric 7.0. Here are some of the things we know about it so far. Generative design. PTC acquired Frustum in 2018. For those of you unfamiliar with generative design, it is the application of machine learning and artificial intelligence to the design process. Creo Parametric 7.0 also has added ANSYS AIM capabilities for multi-physics modeling, including computational fluid dynamics with Creo Simulation Live. Also in Creo Parametric 7.0, we get multi-body modeling. People have been asking for multi-body for years, so this will be highly appreciated by customers. Now that we've taken a look at the past and present, it's time to look to the future. One tool that helps assess strategy and your business's position is a SWOT analysis. SWOT stands for strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. Strengths and weaknesses are internal, and opportunities and threats are external to your organization. I highly encourage you to perform a SWOT analysis of the CAD and PLM implementations at your own product development organizations. Here's my SWOT for the state of PTC, CAD, and PLM. First, strengths. I don't think any other CAD software compares to the breadth and depth of capabilities available in Creo Parametric. With Creo, you get industry-leading capabilities, including design, analysis, and manufacturing all within the same platform, freeform, freestyle, and technical surfacing, large assembly management, and top-down design, and the ability to drive your models with engineering calculations via MathCAD. Next strength, PTC's acquisition and partnership strategy. I already mentioned Onshape and Frustum. Let's take a look at some of the other recent purchases. In 2018, PTC acquired Frustum, an advanced generative design software company. And as I mentioned, in April, we'll get generative design powered by artificial intelligence in Creo Parametric 7.0. The cloud computing option in 7.0 will actually be powered by the software as a service, or SaaS, functionality from Onshape. Waypoint Labs provides the ability to generate process plans using augmented reality. Many of you have probably seen this demonstrated at LiveWorks. Kepware Technologies has been around since 1995, providing companies with connectivity solutions for the Industrial Internet of Things, or IIoT. Their products include KepServer EX, LinkMaster, Redundancy Master, and Client Ace. Vuforia provides solutions for building CAD-based computer vision and augmented reality apps. These can be used on mobile devices like tablets and smartphones, as well as digital eyewear. ThingWorks is a complete end-to-end platform for the development and deployment of both Internet of Things and augmented reality apps. PTC partnered with Cimerix to provide the first computational fluid dynamics, or CFD, solution inside of Creo Parametric. And the partnership with ANSYS provides real-time structural, thermal, and modal simulation of parts and assemblies in Creo Parametric. And as I mentioned earlier, in 7.0, we get computational fluid dynamics and multi-physics simulation via ANSYS AIM. Now let's talk about weaknesses. And I take no joy talking about this area, and I hope I don't offend anyone. My intention is not to denigrate the software, but perform an honest assessment to see where it can be improved. Over a decade ago, I was in the training business, and my coworker and I would deliver training at Blue Origin. One day, Jeff Bezos popped into a class my coworker was teaching and looked at the Pro Engineer interface. This was around the Wildfire 4.0 days, and thought it was too complicated. I'm going to push back against this a little bit. It's always struck me as odd that people expect us to spend 4 years in college learning how to become an engineer, but think that they should be able to drive design software without any training whatsoever. When I've driven software from the competitors, when I found simpler interfaces and workflows, invariably I found less functionality. It's a trade-off, but we have to acknowledge the public perception that Creo is harder to learn and use than other software. Windchill can perform an astounding variety of different PLM functions: CAD data management, change management, BOM management, manufacturing process planning, supplier management, collaboration. I could go on and on. This is a strength that sometimes manifests as a weakness. There are so many different things that Windchill does, and so many different ways you can do various operations, and so many ways that you can customize functions and workflows. That results in a lot to the interface. For many users, especially non-CAD users and infrequent users, it can be overwhelming. As an alternative, you can use Profiles or the various role-based Navigate apps, which I'm a big fan of. But for the majority of users who access the main Windchill interface, they're pretty much getting a one-size-fits-all experience. Now let's talk about opportunities. Opportunities, again, are external factors that can be used to your advantage. The world is getting more digital. Statista Research Department estimates that at the end of 2019, there are 26.66 billion connected devices worldwide. The global population is 7.8 billion, so that comes out to 3.4 devices for every man, woman, and child on the planet. The number of connected devices is expected to jump to 75.44 billion by 2025. That's 2.8 times as many connected devices in 5 years. Google, Facebook, and Amazon are working on satellites, drones, and balloons for more complete global wireless internet access. Internet connectivity and access will continually improve over time. Elon Musk's Neuralink company is working on brain implants to allow you to control phones, computers, and other devices with your mind. Facebook's Building 8 Research and Development Division is working on brain-to-computer interfaces that use optical imaging to scan your brain hundreds of times a second so you can type without using your fingers. Neither of those things scare me. They don't scare you, right? To be clear, I'm being sarcastic. Increasing digitalization is going to happen regardless. It represents an opportunity that CAD and PLM can take advantage of. Some of these ways include greater access to our CAD authoring tools and data silos. Onshape excels at this today. Industrial Internet of Things and virtual factories, a digital twin for your manufacturing floor. And I'm going to mention one topic that every time I bring it up, I get angry emails. Model-based definition, also known as MBD. Maybe we can free ourselves finally from 2D drawings in the 2020s. In the 2019 recap, I talked about PTC's acquisition of Onshape. Creo Parametric has a guiding principle that a model created in version 1 of ProEngineer has to be able to be retrieved and regenerated correctly 32 years later and beyond. Onshape had the advantage of starting over in 2012, being able to keep the best of what's come before and invent new solutions to old problems. Last year, I performed an analysis of 2,500 tickets from end users at Blue Origin. Here are some of the most common problems that administrators like me spend their time on. The software didn't install correctly on my computer. With cloud-based CAD, there is no local installation. We're upgrading to the newest version of the software, so before everyone leaves on Friday, check in all your work. Well, in Onshape, upgrades are automatically pushed out to users behind the scenes. My work didn't save. There's actually no save button in Onshape. Every action is automatically recorded. I can't check out or I can't check in. With Onshape, there is no checking out or checking in. Multiple people can work on the same object at the same time. Collaboration is built into Onshape. Cloud-based CAD helps ensure that people are accessing the right information. It reduces the chances that your manufacturers are looking at the wrong version of a drawing and helps eliminate the confusion between the last released and latest versions of an object. Now let's look at the final element in the SWOT analysis, threats. Now, if you're like me, you probably work with people who are always badgering you or your companies to switch to SOLIDWORKS or CATIA or Inventor or NX. Displacements will happen, and here's why. It's always easier to blame your CAD tool than to take a hard look at the mirror and admit that we are the reason that our project is failing, whether it's our management, our engineering, our processes, our culture. We don't want to blame ourselves. Once we accept that there is a problem, our product isn't working, we're behind schedule, or massively over projected costs, we have to take action to prove to the bosses we're fixing it. Switching our CAD tool shows that we're taking action. Zero cost solutions like changing process or internal business rules don't give the higher ups that warm fuzzy feeling they get from hiring consultants or commissioning software. If you throw a lot of money at it, like switching to another CAD or PLM platform, especially one that's more expensive, that really tells management you're working on the problem. Displacements are going to happen. It's a fact of life. I have competition here under threats, but competition is a good thing. Here's a quote about competition that I like. There is a tendency among some businesses to criticize and belittle their competitors. This is a bad procedure. Praise them. Learn from them. There are times when you can cooperate with them to their advantage and to yours. Speak well of them and they will speak well of you. You can't destroy good ideas. Take advantage of them. I agree with this. I've personally stopped bashing SOLIDWORKS, CATIA, Inventor, NX, and so on. There's a lot that they do well and there's a lot that PTC can learn from them or steal. The acquisition of Onshape in partnership with Ansys speaks to this idea of benefit through cooperation with competitors. I used to work for Blue Origin, a human spaceflight company founded by Jeff Bezos. NASA is seeking bids for its Artemis project, the return to the moon. Blue Origin could have done its own thing, submitted a proposal as a sole venture. One of our business teams figured out there's an advantage to forming a national team with partners with a lot more experience. Lockheed Martin is doing the Ascent Element Vehicle, flight operations, and training. Northrop Grumman is doing the Transfer Element Vehicle. Draper Labs, an offshoot from MIT, is handling guidance and avionics. Blue Origin, the youngest of the bunch, is doing the Descent Element Vehicle, but as prime contractor is managing the program. Competition makes you better. It's a threat, but one that we can use to our advantage. Next threat, the shifting burden of PLM tasks and responsibilities onto engineers. And this isn't the first time something like this has happened. Have any of you worked at companies where engineers perform drafting? There used to be a profession called drafter. These days, engineers and technical designers share drafting responsibilities between them. When I was at Lockheed Martin and Boeing in the 1990s, we had dedicated drafting checkers. We had professionals who managed the release of our drawings, walking the physical drawing package to the desks of the people who needed to sign off on it. We had people who helped write the engineering change orders, who managed the bills of material, and who tracked our deviations and waivers. At the time, we didn't call them product lifecycle management professionals, but that's what they were. I'm not reminiscing for the good old days. I'm lamenting that we've shifted the burden of PLM onto engineers and designers, perhaps by making the PLM tools available within the CAD software or from a web browser. We've made them too easy to access. Every hour engineers and designers spend on PLM tasks is an hour they could and should be spending on engineering and design. Somehow we have to rein in this scope creep. I'm going to talk about an external threat that I've really only seen emerge in the past few years. Most likely your company uses some kind of group messaging or chat like Slack, HipChat, Microsoft Teams, or something else. It's supposed to be the new water cooler. It's supposed to enable the free exchange of ideas and foster interaction unrestrained by geography. What's the problem with these tools? For one thing, it gives everyone a voice, and we all know that the loudest voices speaking with unearned authority dominate the conversation and shape the debate. It's a prime example of the internet's self-confidence problem. The wrong people have too much of it. At Blue Origin, we found that the boards were becoming increasingly toxic. People say all sorts of things, mean, ugly, hurtful comments, behind a keyboard that they wouldn't say in person or in an email. There's another effect that's potentially worse to productivity than the toxic atmosphere that's generated. It allows incorrect information to be spread faster than ever before. I see end users with very solipsistic attitudes. If I don't know how to do something in Creo Parametric, then Creo Parametric isn't capable of doing it. We CAD administrators spend far too much time correcting misinformation that's getting spread in these venues. I'm not trying to be Grandpa Simpson here. The reason we identify threats in the SWOT analysis is so that we can figure out how to reduce the negative impact, eliminate the threat, or turn that negative into a positive. People love social media. The tools make communication, collaboration, and sharing fast and easy. How can CAD and PLM capitalize on the power of social media? Easier commenting in Windchill and Creo, similar to wikis and Jira, instant messaging tools within Creo and Windchill, and the ability to capture and share images quickly and easily. So that's my personal SWOT analysis for the state of PTC CAD and PLM. Before we get into the future, I want to talk about a potential approach for finding solutions. First principles thinking. I'm not a big fan of Elon Musk, but he's a proponent of first principles thinking, and it has guided his approach to SpaceX and Tesla. He advocates using fundamental truths to finding creative solutions to problems, as opposed to analogies, which he calls copies with slight variations. The first principles school of thought was developed by Aristotle, who was an empiricist. According to Wikipedia, in philosophy, empiricism is a theory that states that knowledge comes only or primarily from sensory experience. Aristotle's approach was to use experience to gain knowledge, apply reason to give it structure, in order to form an organized body of knowledge. Let me revisit the concept of analogies as copies with slight variations. And eagle-eyed viewers will recognize that this slide is a copy of slight variations of one that I used a few slides earlier. I started out in industry at Martin Marietta when we still had a real engineering vault. You would literally sign out and check out drawing packages. When I first learned Pro Interlink 3.x, the analogy carried over. You have the engineering vault, the common space, and you check out models and drawings so that you can work on them at your desk, your workspace. Here in 2020, we are still using the same analogy in Windchill. The four steps to the first principles approach are, first, state your vision or goal. This is some version of to know the truth. Second, identify your obstacles and necessary actions. This means questioning the assumptions and lies that you have believed in. Third, break down your current assumptions. This leaves you with first principles. Fourth and finally, build a new creative solution. In other words, find the truth. Like I said in my key point, it's incumbent upon us to think big and think bigger. Before we transition to the future, one short trip to the past. Last summer, there were a lot of celebrations of the 50th anniversary of the Apollo 11 moon landing. On May 25th, 1961, John F. Kennedy made his speech to Congress stating his goal.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the earth.
Apollo 11 launched on July 16th, 1969. It traveled 238,000 miles to lunar insertion orbit in 76 hours. The lunar module separated from the command module and landed on the moon after 102 hours of mission time.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
At 124 hours into the mission, the lunar module lifted off from the surface of the moon. 3.5 hours later, the Apollo 11 lunar lander reunited with the command module. And finally, after 8 days and 3 hours, they splashed down in the Pacific Ocean. Today, we still talk about moonshots and moonshot thinking and moonshot goals. Alphabet, the parent company of Google, calls their X division the Moonshot Factory. Moonshots are goals that seem impossible, fantastical, literally unbelievable until you break them down to their component elements and devise new solutions. What technology enables us to embrace moonshot thinking? How do we think big? It means capitalizing on trends like analytics and big data, artificial intelligence and machine learning, and cloud computing. Many companies have realized that their customers provide them with a lot of data that they can take advantage of. Every click is a data point. Let's look at how some companies mine big data to improve their operations. Amazon uses big data to figure out search results. They have even developed algorithms that figure out when to move products closer to you before you've even purchased them. YouTube's algorithm aims to keep you watching videos because the longer your viewing session, the more ads they can show you. Netflix records every time you stop a video and how much you watch. They use this data to influence script development for original programming. Enterprise resource planning systems collect data to perform business analytics and generate predictive maintenance recommendations. Maybe we can use CAD data for predictive training, predictive modeling, and predictive model maintenance. Again, every click is a data point. The next technology for moonshot thinking, artificial intelligence and machine learning. Creo Parametric has taken advantage of artificial intelligence and machine learning since Creo Parametric 5.0 with the introduction of topology optimization. And again, in Creo Parametric 7.0, we get generative design. Let's talk about some other areas where computer-aided design is ripe for the application of artificial intelligence. How many people have gotten to the end of an assembly modeling session knowing that you've got a couple hours of hardware population ahead of you? We've already got great tools like the Intelligent Fastener extension. Onshape has predefined hardware libraries as well. We all have reams of knowledge and documented standard practices to which we can apply machine learning to perform automatic hardware selection and placement. Cable harness design begs to benefit from AI. First, let's take a look at wiring diagrams. Schematics creation, regardless of what software you use, is still a highly manual task. Part of the problem is that we keep treating schematics like drawings. Everyone creates schematics with formats, zones, title blocks, and revision blocks. Going back to first principles, we typically need schematics for two main purposes. First, to help automate the 3D routing process in CAD, and second, to support fabrication and test. Once you know what needs to be connected and what pinouts to use, AI can figure out what size connectors to use, wire gauge based on initial estimates for voltage drop, and poka yoke to reduce the chance of human error. Poka yoke is how you use different size connectors with different keying to reduce the chance of someone plugging the wrong connector into the wrong place. This again is an area with a wide body of knowledge. On the other side of cabling is the 3D routing of harnesses in an assembly. As one of my colleagues has stated, routed mechanical systems, cabling, is the Rodney Dangerfield of mechanical engineering. It gets no respect. Another of my colleagues has pointed out, almost no mechanical engineers come out of school saying, cable harness design is my passion. Yet, it's one of the most critical aspects of electromechanical product design. My former boss at Amazon came from a video game background, and he made the connection that routing wires and cables in an assembly model is very much like video game algorithms for finding a path through a maze. Do you think we can teach machine learning to do this? And have any of you used outside manufacturing shops like Protolabs? My coworkers and I have always wondered how you can send them your designs one day and they manufacture it the next. The answer is more than by sending them a whole lot of money. Do they have software that automates CNC toolpath generation? CNC machining really is an art and a skill. There's significant value to the decades of experience that machinists have acquired. Can that be coded into artificial intelligence algorithms? I want to go back to Onshape and PLM. It has me rethinking first principles around product lifecycle management. They organize objects into documents, which are collections of part studios, assemblies, drawings, and other related files. You can use the same part names in multiple different documents. Also, you have real-time collaboration. As I mentioned earlier, there is no checking in or checking out. You can see when others are making changes to different entities in your document, and you can chat with them. I'm still wrapping my head around these methods of CAD data management. I can see the benefits to this model. Here's what I find important. They decided to rethink their approach to data management because of new technology, the cloud, instead of replicating the old methods. This is first principles thinking. When we take technology like big data, artificial intelligence, and cloud computing, and then apply first principles thinking, there's no reason we can't achieve moonshots like automating design, routed systems, and manufacturing. We can take those comic book fantasies and turn them into reality. And one last note before I finish up. Pretty much everyone here is involved in product development and manufacturing. Have you ever considered how important this is to society? In 2017, the gross world product, the combined GDP of the entire world, was $80.2 trillion. According to the World Bank, manufacturing accounted for 15.6%, or almost one-sixth of that. In 2018, the gross domestic product of the United States was $20.58 trillion. Manufacturing accounted for almost 11.3% of that. And there's most likely an international audience on this call. Manufacturing accounts for 19% of the GDP of our neighbor to the south and 11% of the one to the north. Germany, 23%. China, 27%. Italy, 16%. South Korea, 29%. Taiwan, 31%. Manufacturing is the backbone of our national and global economies. When we work in and support the manufacture of goods, we're providing a vital service to our countries, our communities, and our families. In the Army, there's a term called a force multiplier. The definition in Wikipedia is that it's a factor or combination of factors that gives personnel, weapons, or hardware the ability to accomplish greater things than without it. Many of us here are engineers or technical designers. We could work as engineers, designers, managers, and so on. But by working as specialists in CAD and PLM technology, we've become force multipliers in our companies. We empower our engineering, design, and manufacturing staffs to accomplish more than they can without us. So what we do at our companies and here is important. Now let's get to work and let's think big. Let's find our moonshots and apply first principles thinking to them. Thank you very much.
David, thank you. Great presentation. So we are open now. If you would like to ask any questions, please do through the Q&A, and I'll monitor those and provide that to David to respond. So anyone has any questions? While you're typing those in, again, just emphasize that the recording and the presentation will definitely be available within 1 week of today. We'll try to do as quickly as possible. It's just a number of steps we have to do in order to do that. So I see, Joe, you have a question. Can you type that question in? It saves trying to switch over the audio and having issues. If you can just type it in and we'll monitor that, and maybe that's coming through now. Okay, well, Joe, while you type that in, we have another question from Thomas Chow. Do you think the current remote rush will push Onshape more into acceptance?
That is a great question, and I absolutely believe that it will. Again, having installations locally to your computer provides a number of problems. I know when I was finishing up my time at Blue Origin, we had a number of people who only had desktop computers, and they didn't have permission to take those home. So even though we were trying to social distance, people were forced to come into the office just to access their computers. Everyone has computers at home, and Onshape allows you to even do CAD work on your smartphone. And so we're going to see a number of changes in society in the next few years as a result of this global pandemic. And I think one of them will be the move to having more software be available through web browsers. I can see that happening to other PTC products like MathCAD as well.
Good. Excellent. So we got Joe's question in. Any improvements on the G, D, and T modules from Creo 4?
So the answer to that, have there been any improvements to the GD&T module since Creo 4, is yes. Actually, every single version, Creo 5 and Creo 6, have brought the GD&T functionality closer to the latest standards. And also, there's information now available. I saw that. I think it was Sean sent out an email to people on the PTC mailing list that you can now check out the enhancements to Creo Parametric 7.0. And those also include improvements to the GD&T functionality. So I highly encourage you to check out that information.
Very good. From Ted, we have, do you have any recommended path to get from Creo to Onshape?
So the answer is just do it. You can sign up for an Onshape account, and pretty much as soon as someone from Onshape reviews it, you get access to the software. And I would encourage you to do what I did, which is just jump in and see if you can figure it out. If you've used Creo Parametric, using Onshape will be pretty straightforward to you. Also, one of the great things about Onshape is they provide free training. And I really love the model that they use for their training, which is a bunch of videos. They are short in length, typically between 2 and 4 minutes. And so you can just watch one of those short videos, jump into the software, and try it for yourself. Again, the basic accounts are free. Just pick it up. And again, you can access it from a web browser. You can even do it from your smartphone.
Okay, great. Thank you. Raghu, how much overlap does Onshape have with Creo Parametric in terms of functionality?
Like I was just mentioning, if you've done part modeling in Creo Parametric, you shouldn't have any problem figuring it out in Onshape. Onshape's tools are a lot more streamlined, so you're not going to see all the different kinds of bells and whistles that you have, for example, in the round feature or the draft feature, but the functionality that you see there should be able to get you to do at least 95% of what you're used to doing in Creo Parametric. And one of the things that I can understand about why PTC acquired Onshape is that it really gives them great inroads into the small to medium business space, whereas Creo Parametric is more to the medium to high end business space. So again, if you have done part modeling, you shouldn't have any problems. When it comes to assembly modeling, it's a little different. In some ways, it's easier for starting out an assembly, especially if you've created a bunch of different parts together in a part document, if they've got interdependencies. But again, all you have to do is watch those short little videos and you'll be able to pick it up without any problems.
Excellent. Good. We've got 4 minutes left. We'll try to get through as many as we can. We have quite a few questions. Can you expand on the shift away from 2D drawings? Our company is attempting a paperless environment.
So that's another good question. And there is a NIST study, NIST, that shows that if you go to a model-based definition process, then you're able to reduce the design to manufacturing to inspection process by 72%. And so it's about reducing all that extra work that you do in the process of drawings and then converting those drawings into what can be manufactured and inspected. And so again, as PTC provides more support to the tools, and especially as manufacturing comes more on board with supporting STEP AP 242 formats, we're going to see a greater increase in the ability to actually adopt MBD at our different companies.
Good, very good. Okay, well, let's take, we're coming to the end. We'll talk about what we'll do next because we have a lot of questions coming through, which are great. So it was stated earlier that no other product has the breadth and depth of Creo Parametric. I'm not sure what the question is, but I think you emphasized that.
So yes, that is, again, from my personal SWOT analysis, that's what I believe as the strength. Again, when you're doing a SWOT analysis, it will incorporate a lot of your own opinions and your mileage may vary.
Very good. Very good. Okay. We'll take one more question I'll put, and then I'll cover the one about the next step. So could you comment on PTC support of the QIF standard for communication of G, D, and T and other specifications? Or is PTC supporting the STEP standard for interoperability?
So I don't know where PTC is heading in terms of QIF. That is a very good question. I know that when I was involved, when I was at Blue Origin, we were looking at QIF, especially for tracking things like first article inspection. So I would like to see PTC get more engaged in that. I don't know their level of commitment to that though.
Okay, very good. So let's pause there. We have a great list of Q&A to go, which we want to make sure we're respectful of everybody's time. David and I will get together and we'll talk about what we should do as far as the follow-up, whether it's a textual follow-up or we do a schedule another one to address the Q&A. We've done that before. Can be very flexible. So we appreciate it, all the questions. Comments about David's presentation, excellent presentation, David. Thank you. If you're interested in what's coming in the future, keep an eye on the newsletters. We're doing those newsletters regularly from PTC users. So as long as you're registered, you'll see those as far as what's coming next, either from David or anyone else. The recording will be available within the week, as I mentioned, and with the static PDF. So again, thank you very much, everyone. It was an excellent presentation, good participation, and we'll be back in touch with all of you soon. So I wish you all to stay safe, to stay healthy, and to keep the collaboration going, right? This is the time where these types of things will make us all closer. So thank you and have a good rest of your day.